Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Wilder Country, Winter, Book 2, written by Mark Smith and read by Ben Hall. For those we lost along the way, Tom, Leonie and Adam. One. The morning air is cold, but the storm from last night has cleared and the wind is feathering the peak at the river mouth. Rowdy waits patiently on the lookout platform while I change into my wetsuit and pull my board out from its hiding place in the tea trees. Before long, I'm duck diving under the waves as they hit the inside bar, the freezing water finding the holes in the stitching and my bare skin underneath. When I reach clear water, I catch my breath and ease into a steady rhythm, paddling towards the peak. The winter storms have shifted the sand, and it'll take me a while to get used to how the wave is breaking. When I get close, I sit up on my board and take stock. The peak is further along the beach than I've seen it before, almost in line with the platform, but provided the channel is still shallow enough, the waves should break all the way through to the river mouth. Sitting out here, it's hard not to remember what it was like before the virus. Surfing with my mates, the beach dotted with swimmers and walkers, the lifesavers' flags flapping yellow and red in the offshore breeze. On the other side of the dunes, the car park would be overflowing on a day like this. The road choked with cars and caravans, and the town buzzing with holidaymakers. Across the river and up the hill, Mum would be out in the garden weeding or pruning, and Dad would be in the shed stripping back an old table, the smell of dust and linseed oil hanging in the air. But when I look now, I can see all the way back up the river to the road bridge and the ruins on the main street. The shells of burnt out shops and abandoned cars. It's hard to keep track of time when you're on your own, but there have been 3 winters since the virus spread beyond the cities, reaching us and forcing the town into quarantine. That's when Dad died. And 2 winters ago, I lost Mum. Everyone else in town was either killed by the virus or took their chances heading north, leaving me and Rowdy to fend for ourselves. We did okay, hunting and fishing and staying out of sight. Then Rose came. Everything changed the day she appeared on the beach, scared, injured and pregnant, and escaped shyly on the run from Ramage and the Wilders. Taking her in and hiding her unleashed a shitstorm. First there was the journey north to find her sister Kas, then the escape back to the coast with Willow in tow, and finally, on the worst night of my life, Rose dying as hope was born. The swell is a little unsettled, and I need to be careful not to get too far inside the peak. Dad always said the best way of starting a surf was to take off on the biggest wave you could get. Opening your account, he called it. So I ease over the top of the first 4 waves, each one breaking a little further out, until I'm in perfect position for the next one. I barely have to paddle into the takeoff, just a couple of deep strokes and the rest is muscle memory. I'm a little slow to my feet, but I balance myself and feel the beautiful rush of the drop down the face. As usual, I lose all sense of time in the water, and before I realize it, the sun's above the ridge and there are new storm heads building in the west. Kas and Willow will be awake wondering when I'll be back. So I take one last wave, riding it all the way to the beach, where Rowdy paces up and down the sand, chasing seagulls he'll never catch. He brushes past my leg as we make our way back up the dune to the platform. The winter has almost passed, and Kas, Willow and I have welcomed the return of some warmth to the air. It's been a winter of storms, with huge fronts coming straight up from the south smashing into the coast. There's damage all over Angowrie. Big trees uprooted, roofs blown off, and the river flooding right up into town on the king tides. In a strange way, the harsh weather's kept us safe. We've been isolated for months. The road north is blocked, and there's snow on the ridges. As long as I've been alive, it hasn't snowed this close to the coast. But the weather's so cocked up now, everything feels like it's never happened before. We figure the Wilders were forced back to Longley to sit out the winter. But with the warmer days, they'll be out on the hunt again soon. It's been a tough time for all 3 of us. But Kas has been the worst affected. Rose's death hangs over everything she does. She stays in her room for days at a time, refusing food and snapping at Willow and me when we try to cheer her up. She's a different person now. I'd hoped when we got back to Angowrie, she'd gradually work her way through the grief. But every time I've tried to comfort her, to hold her, or even touch her, I've felt her resistance. No matter what we talk about, she always ends up back at Ray's place that night. Rose dying, Ramage arriving to claim his child, and us running from the Wilders. She hardly mentions hope. It's too hard, on top of all her grief, to think of what might have happened to the baby. I've spent the winter worrying about Ray. He's used to being on his own, but he's so isolated out there in the Addiscot Valley. It's only a couple of hours away on foot, but he's too old to travel far, and I know the storms will have tested him. He'll be struggling to get out and work his garden. Not that much would have grown in the cold months. Before the weather got really bad, I thought if we went out to visit him, Kas could at least see where Rose was buried. But she kept putting it off, always finding excuses. The first few weeks after Rose died were the hardest. The full force of winter hadn't arrived yet, and we had to be extra cautious moving around Angowrie, not knowing if the Wilders stayed south of the main range. I didn't believe they'd leave us alone. They'd figure we had food supplies hidden somewhere. And Ramage still wanted to take Kas back to Longley. As far as he was concerned, she was a Siley and his property. Back then, I wasn't prepared to risk trapping along the fences. It's what they'd be expecting, that we'd return to a place we knew we could get food. As long as we stayed in town, kept out of sight, lit a fire only on moonless nights, and got by as best we could, I thought we'd be safe. So we relied on what food we could pick off the reef, mostly pippies and mussels exposed at low tide. Rowdy rushes ahead once we get close to home. By the time I'm through the back door, he's lapping water from his bowl in the corner. Kas and Willow sit at the kitchen table peeling hard-boiled eggs. Willow looks up and smiles.
How was the surf?
I cup my cold hands on the side of her face and she reels away. A bit chilly, I say. Kas forces a smile then goes back to the eggs. This is what she's like now. Only half with us, hardly joining in, as though it would be some sort of crime. With Kas off in her own world, Willow's become my shadow. She's always watching me, asking a million questions about rabbits and hunting and living off the land. I decided last night that we should start trapping again, and she's excited to get going. After breakfast, she sits on the back porch watching me oil the traps. The wind has turned, and another storm is threatening. She pulls her favorite woolen coat tight around her shoulders. We needed to find some clothes for her when we got back from Ray's, so I went through all the houses in the area. Eventually, I found a heap of kids' clothes in the place at the top of Parker Street. She had a great time trying them on, parading up and down the hallway. Even Kas managed to smile.
"Show me how to do that,"
she says, coming and kneeling next to me on the grass. I work the trap's jaws open and shut while she drips oil into the spring. I look up and see the concentration on her face. Everything focused on what she's doing, as though this is a skill she'll need to hang on to. She pushes the hair off her face with an oily hand and catches me looking.
"What?"
she says.
"Nothing,"
I say, trying not to smile. She's easy to be around. I never have to second guess her or worry about upsetting her. She's turned out to be a tough kid. The storm is short and sharp, exhausting itself in 15 minutes. When we're ready to leave, I stick my head in the door and tell Kas we're heading up to the fences. She's still at the table with the same blank look on her face that she's had since we got back from Ray's. I so much want the old Kas back, the one that was funny and warm. She looks the same, her hair thick and tangled and falling across her face, deep brown eyes, the skin dark around the birthmark on her cheek. But there's something missing. The spark that made her who she was. Even though she's been right here, sleeping in the next room, eating at the same table, warming herself by the same fire. She might as well have been on another planet. I'm taking Wills with me, I say.
Sure. Whistle when you come back.
This is the way she talks now. In short little sentences, like anything else is too much effort. We head out with the traps, keeping to the back tracks and staying alert for any sign of danger. The storm damage is everywhere. Fallen branches and uprooted trees block our way at every turn. Only Rowdy is unconcerned, darting ahead, happy to be active again after a slow couple of months. He senses the familiarity of it, though this time with Wills included in our little party. It's easy to forget she's only 9 or 10 years old. She doesn't wander or dawdle like a kid would anymore. She walks with purpose, keeping her eyes and ears open. And she's been practicing with the bow and arrows. At the beginning of winter, she set up a target in the backyard, an old mattress with a bullseye painted in the middle. At the start, I think she did herself more damage than the target. She had big red welts on her arm where the string hit her. But gradually, she got the hang of it. Now she can hit the target from the other side of the yard. And when she isn't practicing, she'll be in the shed sharpening the metal tips of the arrows. It takes twice as long to get up to the ridge as it would have before the winter. We approach the fence slowly, but everything looks the same. The burnt-out hay shed is still a tangle of steel girders and blackened rafters, all collapsed into a heap. I know this place well. I've been setting my traps here since before Mum died. Further along, we come to the gateway where I knocked Ramage off his trail bike. I'd strung a length of wire across the opening so he'd hit it at speed. He was injured, and I had a knife to his throat, but somehow I couldn't finish him off. Now I wonder how things might have been different if I'd killed him when I had the chance. Maybe he wouldn't have attacked the valley, forcing us to escape with Willow. Maybe Rose would be alive. Maybe she and Hope would be living with us, and Kas would be a different person. Finding a small gap in the bottom of the fence, I dig the first trap in and push hard on the spring to set the plate. Willow squats next to me and watches. This is where you've got to be careful, Wills. If the plate doesn't catch, it'll snap shut and you'll lose a finger. The plate holds, and I sprinkle some dry leaves over the top to hide the metal. Willow is holding her breath. Rowdy knows to stay well clear. We set 4 traps at intervals along the fence. It's slow going on the way back down. Willow walks out in front, checking every now and again to check I'm keeping up. When we reach the lookout above the old football ground, we sit down for a rest and scan the town below for any sign of danger. From up here, I can pick every street, every shortcut and trail through the dunes. This is my town, my fortress against the wilders. If they come again, I can outwit them. I know the terrain so much better than they ever will. Willow sits next to me and says, "When is Kas going to be happy again, Finn?" "It's going to take a while, I think." Willow sighs and looks out to the blue line of the horizon. "She cries in the night," she says. "She'll get better. We've just got to look after her until she does." "Finn," Willow says suddenly. She points to where the main road winds down into town. There's movement, something catching the light. I can't hear anything above the sound of the wind whipping through the trees, but I watch a gap in a bush a little further down and wait to see what emerges. There may be 6 or 7 of them. We're too far away to work out who they might be, but they're moving slowly. I can't see any weapons, but they're pushing handcarts piled with sacks. I'm hoping they're drifters, like the ones that passed us when Harry had me blindfolded up above Pinchgut Junction. Rowdy's picked up their scent and he stands to attention. Keeping low, we take off down the track to the river bridge, arriving before they get there. We make our way across and hide just off the road in a low stand of tea tree. The first thing I want to see is that they're not wilders. After a few minutes, they come to the bridge and stop. There are 6 men and 2 boys. Drifters for sure. Their clothes hang off them and they hold rags over their mouths as though the air is dirty. Their hair is long and matted and their eyes dart left and right. One of them, a tall man with a stooped back, walks out onto the bridge and looks up and down the river. Willow lies next to me holding her breath. Rowdy crouches low, ready to spring at them if he has to. I touch him gently on the nose, but he stays alert.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.